हेलो फ्रेंड्स, कैसे हैं आप लोग? सो व्हाट वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस टुडे इज वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस अबाउट राइट अगेंस्ट एक्सप्लॉइटेशन। दिस राइट अगेंस्ट एक्सप्लॉइटेशन हैव बीन ग्रांटेड अंडर टू आर्टिकल्स ऑफ आवर इंडियन कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन। दीज आर्टिकल्स आर आर्टिकल 23 एंड आर्टिकल 24। दीज आर द टू आर्टिकल्स दैट वी विल फोकस ऑन। In our last lecture, I discussed about Article 22 and Article 21. I hope that you have viewed those two articles, and if you have liked them, please comment on those on the part of comment section. So let's start with today's lecture. So in today's lecture, I'm going to cover both of these articles and discuss with you all the basic requirements that I need to tell you about, so as to get a comprehensive view about the law as far as right against exploitation is concerned. Okay, so Article 23 is a provision of fundamental right, as we all know. So what does Article 23 grants to people of India? We will get to know by reading sub-article 1 of Article 23. So sub-article 1 of Article 23 reads that traffic in human beings and beggar and other similar forms of forced labor are prohibited, and any contravention of this provision shall be an offense punishable in accordance with law. See, we are doing this lecture series for quite a time, and I have always told you, when you read a provision, try to break it and understand the meaning of each and every part of it. So it becomes easier to understand the gist of the article. So this is what we are going to do in today's class also. So what does Article 23 say? Article 23, the first term that we need to focus in Article 23 is the term traffic in human beings. What is meant by these words? Traffic in human beings. See, even before this, the question I am going to put to you is, tell me from reading this article, is this Article 23 is available to only citizens of India, or is it available to both citizens and non-citizens? See, there is no term. In all the articles we discussed earlier, there was the use of words either all citizens of India or all persons. But in Article 23, there is no mention of either of those terms. So let me tell you that Article 23 is available to both citizens and non-citizens equally. Okay, this is not citizen-centric article. So now we will move forward to what is meant by these terms, traffic in human beings. So traffic in human beings, what is meant by traffic, or per se trafficking? We all must have heard this word, traffic. What is meant by this? So in a layman language, I'm going to tell you the meaning of this word. Trafficking is when a particular person is made to move from place A to place B without his or her consent and for immoral purposes or illegal purposes. So what are the requirements? The movement of the person against his or her consent and for immoral and illegal purposes. This is what is essentially meant by the term trafficking. So now you may say that this is not what happened every time. There may be cases when young girls, youth of our country may be persuaded to come to a particular place from his hometown, okay, in search of job or some particular activity which may be beneficial for their career. So they may themselves come to that place where they are sold or done away with for immoral purposes. So what happens in that cases? See, the requirements are the same. They are not coming with their own consent. Okay. The consent is not free. If you look at the definition of the term consent, it has to be free, so as to be a valid consent. But in this case, they have been persuaded by presentation of wrong facts to them. They have been told that they will be given a particular job or a particular opportunity, and for that reason they are coming. So as the persuasion is based on wrong facts, and from the initial stages, that particular person has a wrong intention in his mind to traffic that particular person. So the requirements are satisfied in such cases also. So the next thing to focus is trafficking in human beings only. Okay, the term human beings is specifically mentioned. Just suppose if the word trafficking only has been used, so this provision could have been very broad. It may include trafficking in animals also. Trafficking happens in animals also. Okay, they are trafficked for various purposes, so, or other creatures also. But as far as Article 23 is concerned, the Protection Act against trafficking has been limited to human beings first, because this is a provisional fundamental rights. Okay, we may find provisions for the protection of rights of animals in directive principles of state policy, even in our fundamental duties under Article 51A. But as fundamental rights are tend to be essential for human existence, so for that reason they are more or less surrounded around the human beings. Okay, so traffic in human beings, the next term that we need to understand so as to get a picture of Article 23 is the term beggar. Okay, this beggar is not that beggar we find on roads, okay, asking for money and all that is different. Again, this is spelling and the pronunciation is also different. But as far as this term is concerned, B-E-G-A-R, what is meant by this term? This term means that when a particular individual is forced to work or give services without any remuneration, it amounts to this beggarism. Okay? It falls under the category of this term, beggar. Okay, when what are the requirements? That a particular person is working without a remuneration. Okay, obviously without his consent. Otherwise, if a particular person is doing a work without remuneration with his or her consent, then it may amount to altruistic work. Okay, he's himself doing a service to the society or something like that. Okay, but this is against consent. Of service is provided or work is done without remuneration. Okay? Service without remuneration, without consent. Okay, three things. And the final thing is that we need to focus on is other similar forms of forced labor. So what is meant by this term forced labor? It is easy. Forced labor is when a particular person is forced to do a particular job against his consent. Okay, there may be various reasons for this. It may happen that a particular individual belongs to a scheduled caste and he is being forced to do a menial job which he doesn't want to do this. For example, cleaning toilets. Okay, it may happen and it happens every day. So if he is forced to into a particular profession or into a particular job against his own consent, it will amount to forced labor. And so as to broaden the area of Article 23, these generic terms have been used, other similar forms of forced labor. So this Article 23 is not restricting the concept of forced labor to a particular area. Just for an example that I gave in the case of scheduled caste, it includes all kinds of forced labor in which a particular person is being forced to do a particular job against his consent. So what are the three things that Article 23 protects you against? Traffic in human beings, beggar, what is meant by beggar, work without remuneration against consent, and the third is other similar forms of force. Now we will move forward This is all these three things are prohibited. Okay, completely prohibited. When we say that it is prohibited, it means that if a particular person is going to do that work, it will be illegal. Okay, he treads into the area of illegality. Okay, goes beyond the circle of being a legal or being a social or like within the bounds of legality, he trespasses that. Okay, so it is prohibited. And any contravention of this provision shall be an offense punishable in accordance with law. Okay, so we'll go one by one. First thing is, it is prohibited. So the constitution itself, when it was adopted, this practice has become a prohibited thing. So it has been not left to the parliament to enact to prohibit article 20, to prohibit these activities when it feels so. So in this matter, this article 23 is very similar to article 17 of our Indian constitution that we discussed previously, in which case also untouchability was prohibited by the article itself or by the constitution itself, and it was not left to the parliament to prohibit it in future. Okay, so the article 23 itself has made this practicing of any of these three things prohibited. Okay, and any contravention of this prohibition shall be an offense. And the article further says that if the first thing is that it is prohibited, okay, and the next thing is that if a particular person even then does this any of these three activities, it will amount to an offense and he will be punished in accordance with law. Okay, so the only thing that has been left to the parliament is to enact a law in accordance with which a particular person will be punished because he is doing these any of these acts which are prohibited by the constitution. See, divide the section. These three activities prohibited. This is what article 23 provides. Now, it will be an offense in accordance with law. This is for the parliament to do. It is bound to do, but it is for the parliament to do. What to do? That it will enact a law and it will punish the people who do any of these three activities because these three activities are prohibited by article 23. So these two parts, this is what the constitution have done. This is what the parliament is supposed to do, to enact a law and to punish according to that law all the offenders of this article 23. Okay, so the power that has been given, so all these fundamental rights that are requiring the parliament to enact law so as to enforce these articles, so the power to enact those laws have been given to the parliament under article 35 of our Indian constitution that we will discuss in our future classes. So under article 35 of our Indian constitution, parliament has been given power so as to enact the laws and prohibit and punish all those people who have been violating the fundamental rights which require the adoption of a particular law, and article 23 is one of those articles which require adoption of a law so as to punish the offender. So you have seen article 23. Now answer me one question: does article 23 include slavery? You all know what a slavery is. Okay, you must be having a like rough idea what is slavery. So what do you think? Does it include slavery or not? Okay, so the answer is that what is meant by slavery? We say the first thing that we imply by the term use of term slavery is that particular individual a person is being bought and sold. Okay, he is being dealt in such as a commodity in the market. So this is what we imply when we see Hollywood movies and all. So this is what happens. So this is the first thing that strikes our mind when we see slavery. So just go back to article 23. What was the first thing that was prohibited? Was traffic in human goods. What happens in traffic? People buy and sell for money, for immoral purposes. So as far as that concept of slavery is concerned, it is included in article 23, isn't it? What more is meant by slavery? the next thing that comes to our mind when we look at this word slavery is that a particular person is being for is working without any remuneration. A slave doesn't get paid for the work he does. This is the second thing. So this is also included under Article 23 under the term beggar, isn't it? What is more that comes to your mind when you look at the word slavery? The third thing that comes to your mind that all those slaves are forced to work. They may not want to do that work, still they are being forced, and all the kinds of work they are forced to do. So this is also covered under Article 23, all forms of forced labor. So see, our Indian Constitution does not mention the word slavery, but includes all its specific instances. So Article 23, in a way, it's more clear because the term slavery is subject to many interpretations. So as to provide the clarity, what the Constitution maker chose was that instead of providing this broad term of slavery, they provided the specific instances which the Constitution is providing to all the individuals. So it was a better way of drafting our Indian Constitution. So in Article 23 also includes slavery. So if a question comes in what provision this instances of slavery are prohibited in our Constitution, it is Article 23. Okay. So as we discussed earlier that it was left to the state to enact a law and punish all the offenders under those acts. Okay. So in pursuance of that power, the Parliament enacted Suppression of Immoral Trafficking in Women and Girls Act 1956. This is one of the examples. There were many acts that were enacted so as to enforce this provision. This is just an example that so as to make you better understand the provision. Okay, now the case laws. I have mentioned two very important case laws so as to understand Article 23. The first case is Sanjeet Roy versus State of Rajasthan. This is a case of 1983. So the question that arose in this case was that I will put to you, okay? See, when we were discussing the term beggar, what I said that when a particular person is not paid anything for the work he is doing, it amounts to the practice of this beggary. But suppose that a particular person is being paid, but not enough or less than the required standard. Will it amount to the practice of this beggar or not? Or if not, what is it? It's not right, that's for sure. But what is it? Is Article 23 protecting, is covering this aspect also? So this was the question in this case. So in this case, what the Supreme Court held that as the particular person who is being paid less than the minimum standard, it cannot amount to this, cannot fall under the term beggar. Instead, it would amount to forced labor. Now you will be like, why forced labor? See the reasoning of the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court said that when a particular person knows that I'm getting paid very less and still he is continuing with that job, what that means is that he's forced to do that. He has no other option to opt. If he had, he would have switched the job. Because he is doing that job, still doing that job, and he's still getting paid less than the required standard, that means that he's forced by the circumstances. Okay, it is not his will or it is not his consent with which he is doing that work. He's forced by the circumstances. He may not be forced by the employer, but he's forced by the circumstances. And of that, the employer is taking the benefit. So it will instead of falling under the term beggar, it will fall under the definition of forced labor. Okay. In this case, a few individuals were getting paid less than minimum wages. So it was held to be being protected under Article 23 of Indian Constitution under the terminology of forced labor. The Supreme Court also said that the aim of Article 23 and Article 39, which fall under the category of DPSPs, is to ensure economic equality in the societal structure. So as to looking at the aim which this provision has, we have to broaden its purview. We can't hold that this instance is not falling under that specific criteria. We have to interpret the law in such a way that more and more malpractices in the society which are offending against this this principle of economic equality is covered within this Article 23. This was Sanjeet Roy versus State of Rajasthan. This was case of 1983. The next case that I am going to discuss as far as Article 23 is concerned is Dina versus Union of India. This is again a case of 1983. See, in this case also, a very important thing in question arose. See, when a particular person is in prison, he's in jail, okay? And in jail, there are two kinds of punishment that are provided, okay? So, the one kind of punishment is in which a particular person is not forced to work. Okay, this happens in like menial offenses. Okay, and the other kind of punishment that is provided to the people imprisoned is that they are forced to work. Okay, so this a rigor that it falls under the category of rigorous imprisonment. Okay, so they are forced to work. So the question arose that all these prisoners who are working. Okay, who are doing things while they are serving there. So, though it is falling under the category of that they are being punished for what they have done, that is okay. But they are working. We have to accept that also, that they are doing a job, that they are providing a service. We can't deny that. Though they are being punished, but still they are providing a service. Okay. So, and if they are not paid anything, it will fall under the concept of beggar, as we discussed that a particular person is being forced to a particular thing, but he is not getting paid. Okay, so this was a question that if the prisoners are not getting paid, can they come before the Supreme Court and say that no, they are offending our fundamental right under Article 23? So in this case, the Supreme Court held that yes, the law Article 23 does not create any distinction between people who are in prisons and people who are not. Article 23 is equally available to all citizens and non-citizens. And by being imprisoned, a particular individual does not lose his fundamental rights under Article 23. So even if you are taking a service out of a prisoner, which may fall within the purview of its punishment, still, if you are getting a service out of him, you have to pay. So this was the judgment of Dina versus Union of India. This is a case of 1983. Okay, so let's move forward. Okay, so we have discussed Article 23, Subarticle 1. That part provided you the rights against three things. Okay, traffic in human beings, beggar, and forced labor. So as far as Subarticle 2 is concerned, it is an exception to Subarticle 1. Subarticle 1 provided you the rights. Subarticle 2 is creating an exception. What does Subarticle 2 says? Nothing in this article shall prevent the state from imposing compulsory services, mind the words, for public purposes. And in imposing such service, the state shall not make any discrimination on the grounds only of religion, race, caste, or class, or any of. Okay, we'll break this. I will break this subarticle for you also. See, this is non-obstance clause. Nothing in this article. Whenever you see these terms, it means that it is an exception in provision. It is creating an exception to whatever has been given prior to it. Okay, so this is a non-obstance clause. As we have mentioned, this is an exception. Nothing in this article shall prevent the state from imposing what? Imposing what? Compulsory service. Okay, for public purposes. It means that a state may make provision for compulsory services for all citizens or all persons of within the territory of India. But that service, that compulsory, which you are making compulsory for all, has to be for public purposes. This is the only precondition for providing a provision for compulsory service, that compulsory service has to be for public purposes. This is very important to understand. Okay, compulsory service for public purposes. So if a state is making a law according to which that all people have to do a particular thing, and that thing is in the interest of general public, or it is falling under the category of public purposes, that all the individuals or the citizens cannot go before the Supreme Court and say that our rights under Article 23 are being violated because we are not getting paid out of it, falling under beggar, or even if we are getting paid out of it, it is against our intention, forced labor. No, this is an exception. Compulsory service for public purposes. Okay. But the first condition was that it has to be for public purposes. The second condition is that while imposing such services, the state cannot make any discrimination among the citizenry or non-citizenry of India. It cannot say that, and what are the grounds of discrimination? Religion. For example, the state cannot say that all the Hindus will be forced to do that thing, all the Muslim, or the Muslims will be doing this thing for public purposes, Sikhs or Christian or whatever. Okay, so if a state is providing for compulsory services for public purposes, it has to be for all equally, and there should be no discrimination on the basis of religion. Or the same case with race, same case with caste, like Brahmins will be doing it or Kshatriyas will be doing it. No. Now, for the first time, see, we have discussed all the discriminatory provisions, okay, in equality thing. Article 15, Article 16, what are the terms that were used? What are the grounds that were used against the discrimination against which was prohibited, which was religion, race, caste, sex, place of birth, residence? See, there was no mention of class. See, this is for the first time that we are coming across this term, class. Why this new term was used in this sub-article? Not the other terms, and many of those were excluded. Okay, there's no mention of sex. Okay, there's no mention of residence. Okay, but there is a new thing called class. What is this class? What we understand by class is the economic thing, no? That rich class, middle class, or poor class. This is what the generic idea of this term class. So is it used in the same sense? So it is very hard to decipher why this separate term was used, a different term was used. But as far as we are concerned, we have to remember this. Okay. What we have to remember, that there are four grounds that have been provided under Article 23 on the basis of which the state cannot discriminate while providing for compulsory services for public purposes. What were four grounds? Religion, race, caste, or class, or any of them. So there is no mention of sex, residence, or other grounds, and there is the new thing coming, class. This is we need to remember. So I hope this sub-article 2 is clear to you. Just remember three things. The first thing is compulsory. The state can provide for compulsory services. But there are two conditions. The first condition is that it has to be for public purposes. Second, the state can't discriminate on the grounds of religion, race, caste, or class. RRCC. Okay. So I hope I've covered Article 23 in great detail. I hope it is clear to you. So what I am going to do is that I will move forward with our discussion in this video only and try to cover Article 24 also. Okay, so what does Article 24 say? Article 24 says that no child below the age of 14 years, okay, very important to remember, 14 years, shall be employed to work in any factory or mine or engage in any other hazardous employment. Okay. So we'll break this article. There is no sub-articles in this. Okay. There's this one statement. No child. Okay. Again, it is available to all citizen and non-citizen. It is not saying that no child who is a citizen or no child who is a non-citizen. It is just saying no child. It means that it is available to both or citizens and non-citizens. The only condition is that child has to be below the age of 14 years. Okay. He may be of the age of 3 years, 4 years, 5 years, 8 years, 10 years, 12 years, 13 years, 14 years, but not 15 years. Okay. So the bar has been set. The upper bar has, there's no lower bar. There is this upper bar, 14 years. this protection is available to all people who are coming down of this thing. Okay, so the age of 14 years shall be employed to work in any factory or mine. So three things have been provided. Factory, any factory, whatever be the area of trade. Okay, it may be textile, it may be steel, it may be iron or whatever. Okay, so if it is a factory, it is falling under the definition of factory. No child below the age of 14 years will be employed in it. Okay, the second term used is mine. Okay, this is oil mine, gold mine, whatever. Okay, if it is falling under the term of coal mine or whatever kind of mine, this a kid below the age of 14 years will not be employed in that. And the last part of this sub-article broadens this area. Okay, and says as engage in any other hazardous employment. Okay, so there are n numbers of employments which are hazardous, and it is not possible for the constitution, it was not possible for the constitution makers to provide each and every of it specifically. The terms that were popular at that point of time for hazardous activities were factory and mine. So those were the terms that they used. But first, to broaden and cover the future things that may fall under the hazardous category, they provided for this last term, which was engaged in any other hazardous employment. And it has been left to the parliament and or to the Supreme Court to decide what activity or what employment is falling under this category of hazardous employment. Okay. So it really broadens this, the area of Article 24. So when we see at Article 24, the first thing that we get to know is that it is for the protection of children. Okay. It protects the rights of the child who are below 14 years of age. And what part of their rights? That they shall not be employed in any hazardous activity. Let's move forward. Okay. So, and Article 24 is not the only provision. Okay. Article 24 of our Indian Constitution is not the only provision that provides for the protection of children. Article 39 of DPSV also protects the rights of the child. It provides that the state has a responsibility to ensure and promote health and strength of children, protect them against exploitation. So this is not the only article. It is the only fundamental right that protects the rights of child under the 14 years of age as far as their employment part is concerned. Okay, so in pursuance of Article 24, so as to protect the child below the age of 14 years, many different acts have been adopted, or different articles or sections have been adopted in existing acts so as to protect the rights of the children. For example, Child Labor Prohibition and Regulation Act 1986 was adopted, which clearly specifies what are the industries which cannot employ a child below the age of 14 years because they are held to be hazardous. Okay, this is the act which is specifically dealing with this sub-article, this Article 24. And if we go back to Indian Factories Act, with this act is it came into force even prior to the coming into force of our Indian Constitution or Article 24. So a section has been adopted in this act that which prohibits the employment of children in factories. Okay. And again, the Mines Act, in this all separate sections have been provided, rules have been provided which prohibit the employment of children below the age of 14 years in such employments. Okay. See, let's discuss Article 24. I want to discuss with you a very small thing about Article 24. See, when we were discussing Article 21A, or before that Article 21 and Mohini Jain case, which held that right to education is a part of a fundamental right, and then Article 21A came into being, and it provided that all children between the age of 6 to 14 years have a fundamental right to elementary education. And we, at the same time, we have Article 24, which is prohibiting the employment of children below the age of 14 years. So in a way, both of these articles, Article 21A now and Article 24, are interlinked. Because Article 24, by prohibiting their employment in hazardous activity, is providing opportunity to these children to go and take advantage of this fundamental right. This is the interlinked part. But at the same time, they are contradictory also. Contradictory how? Because this Article 24 is partial. Okay. It is prohibiting the employment of children in hazardous activity only. But it is not prohibiting the employment of children per se. As far as I'm not talking about this act, Child Labor Prohibition and Regulation, mind it. It has clearly broadened this area and it has prohibited the employment of children in anything. Okay. But as far as Article 24 is concerned, if we compare these two articles, we see a contradiction also. That at the one hand, we are providing the right to fundamental right to children to study, and at the same time, we are not prohibiting their employment. So it will be clash between these two rights of the children, right to work or right to education. If they are working, it will be very hard for them to go do well in their education. Okay, that is what we practically get. Okay, this is not the legal argument that I am making. It is just an impression that I am getting from the reading of this article. Okay, one more thing that we need to understand is, see, Article 24 is for the protection of the children. Okay, and Article 21A is also for the protection of the children. See, but it is okay that under Article 21A, the state has made it obligatory for all to get the education, has been made compulsory, free and compulsory. Okay, you are providing free education and you have made it compulsory. So what is required, that the child has to go to school every day, okay, and get the particular education. But suppose that it may happen that there is no other person in the family of that child who is earning, okay, and he has no way to take care of himself and he is forced to work. Okay, it is very necessary for him to work so as to feed himself or his poor old mother or sister, whatever. So in such a situation, can we force that child to go and get education and wait for 10-20 years to get a job? This is very crucial thing that we need to understand. So when we interpret these sub articles, it is not all the goody-goody things that we need to focus on. We also need to focus on the practical implications of them. So the first impression that we get is that, is it good that the employment is being prohibited? But what about the child who is forced, who has no other option but to do this, to do the work? There are an number of families where there is no one to work except for that child. So this is not a negative. It is just a practical challenges that a country faces that it needs to take consideration of. So why I am telling these things, so as to understand, so that you can understand our next case better. This is a case of M.C. Mehta versus State of Tamil Nadu. This is a case of 1997. In this case, again, this question of child employment arose, and a Siva Kasi crackers factory was a PIL was filed against this factory. What it was doing, that it was employing children below the age of 14 years into making into these crackers and everything. So while the whole discussion went on that this is bad, that you are employing children into such an hazardous activity, their education thing is disturbed. So this argument came that it is not just the good for the employer to employ the kids, but it is also the need of these children so that they can feed themselves or their family. So what we are doing about that thing? So this question arose there in this case also. So in this case, a very important thing that the Supreme Court said, that the Supreme Court held that yes, it is prohibited by Article 24 and you cannot employ children below the age of 14 years in such a hazardous activity. First thing, it is clearly held. But at the same time, the Supreme Court also gave the direction so as to establish Child Labor Rehabilitation Welfare Fund. And the Supreme Court held that all the offenders of this act of Article 24 who employ children, a penalty will be imposed on them of an amount of 20,000 at least, which that amount will be put into this welfare fund. And it will be taken care that the fund is used for the welfare of those children who are rescued from those employment. Okay, so a consideration was given to the poorness of those children who were forced to that work, so that they can get benefited out of it. So a fund was created for those children who were rescued from those jobs, and who will pay money to this fund? All those offenders. So it was a good way to like to make a flow of money towards those poor children. Okay, so this was a device that was constituted during the discussion of the case. It also came into light that there is a convention on the rights of the child, of which India is also a signatory, and Article 32 of that international convention also provides that the children below the age of 14 years should not be employed in hazardous activity. So if a particular thing, a factory is employing this, so it is not only violating Article 24, it is also making a violation of this international treaty to which India is bound. So this was also covered, and Supreme Court has already held that all the international convention to which India is a signatory and which has been ratified already automatically becomes a part of Indian law. Okay, it is not necessary in every case that the parliament should bring forth a new act so as to enforce the provisions of the treaty to Indian people. No, it automatically becomes a part of Indian law. So by that interpretation also, it was held that it was wrong that this factory employed kids below the age of 14 years. Okay, so this is what we this was our discussion for today. I hope you have understood what I said. So this part, Article 23 and Article 24, as we discussed, protected the citizenry and non-citizenry of India from provided a right against exploitation in two things. The first, Article 23, was broad. It was not limited to children only, and it provided protection against trafficking, beggarism, and forced labor. And Article 24 provided rights to children below the age of 24 years and protected 14 years and protected them from being employed in hazardous activity. So we will end here, and I'll come forward with my next lecture tomorrow. And I will discuss in that a right of religion, Article 25 to 28. So until then, be safe. Don't go out in this corona thing. Be safe and follow the guidelines, follow the government. And thank you very much. See you soon. Bye.